Good evening. Double standards of condemnations has created a partisan debate about the issue of bad language, intemperate language, abusive language, call it what you want. But the bottom line is that the language of politics is deteriorating. It's been a roller coaster week of a tirade from the MP for Sin Central, Ken Ajapong, to threats on judges issued by some panelists in the media. Well, the Media Foundation for West Africa has also been monitoring the media landscape, and a lot of the time, it seems the opposition NPP has topped the list of those using intemperate language. But it doesn't mean that there aren't others close behind. But is it all that is lost? Is it too late to sanitize the public space? Intemperate language in Ghana's politics tonight on Joint Caucus. I am Jifa Bampo. Thank you very much for joining us here on Joint Caucus on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. Joining us this evening, Mr. Kojo Eduasari, who is a presidential staffer representing the NDC. He's also a former member of parliament for Adenta. And Samuel Abujinapo, private legal practitioner who will be representing the NPP. We'll hear from him once he joins us. But we can also hear your thoughts. You can share your views on 0560-800-000. And that's 0560-800-000. You can also join us on Facebook. It's facebook.com/joynewsontv. Good evening to you, Mr. Eduasari, and thank you for joining us on Joint Caucus for the first time.
Good evening, Difa. Pleasure's mine.
All right. And it's been really a busy week in the public space, I must say, who is saying what, who isn't saying what, and how we should deal with it. First, let me get your view about all these issues that have emerged about the use of language, the sort of language we've heard in the media, in the public space generally. And when I say public space, it's not just the media, there's also social media, newspapers and the like. What's your view on what's going on?
Thank you very much, Jifa. I think it's just that in the last few days, the spotlight or a lot of attention has been given a particular issue, which is what has brought us this far. Because it's not as if these things do not happen on daily basis or weekly basis. They happen. Just that on this particular occasion, some particular group of people were the target of the abrasion, for which reason it appears some people's honestness have been ruffled. So then it calls for public attention, calls for the kind of
debate,
and,
the controversy,
you know,
exactly, that has surrounded it.
Other than that, how many times hasn't the president of this country been insulted on radio on daily basis? How many times has Nanado, the presidential candidate of the NPP, not been insulted on daily basis? It's happening. Once it's about politicians, it's all right. It's okay. I mean, yes, whipping boys, put them on the chopping boards, slash them as much as you can, and they have no say because they don't have parents, they don't have children, they don't have relatives, they don't feel anything. They have insulated,
Or they're expected not to respond to anything.
So it can be done to them. Anything can be unleashed on them. And all the better.
Okay, before we go on that tangent, you mentioned something about some people being targeted.
No,
targeting because it's a question of whether these people brought these things on themselves.
Oh, no,
making the comments that they did.
I didn't mean they've been targeted as in
someone has sought them out to deal with them.
No, okay. That's not what I mean. What I'm saying is that
Or the spotlight has been thrown on them.
Yes, and these people, the target of the abrasion, in this case, the judges, is what has brought this whole
discussion
back. Because, of course, in this case, the fraternity of the judicial system, the Bar Association on one side, and then the magistrates and
Association of magistrates and judges
on the other hand, all of them have crammed together to, you know, express their indignation on this particular issue. So then it has caught fire. Media has held on to it and is also spreading because, yes.
But this issue didn't start just from the threat issued on the judges.
We will stretch beyond that point, but
the truth is, it wasn't from there. The point is, when the MP for Asin Central issued those insulting comments against the chairperson of the Electoral Commission, there was quite a good number of round condemnation. There was from the GBA, there was from the Christian Council, some women's groups criticized the comments, some political party activists, the MDC went into full flight, women in the Eastern region went on a walk or a march of a sort, presented a petition to the Eastern Regional Minister, they've presented a petition to Parliament. Unfortunately, their minority women's caucus declined to meet them and all that. So there was a certain, you know, movement towards raising all these issues and how it should be said, what should be said, who is condemning it, up until this issue with the panelists at Muntier.
You see, this whole thing, let me say, started from this same EC versus Abu Ramadan case at the Supreme Court, where a certain political party and its affiliate organizations, in this case the NPP, Dankwa Buzia on one hand, Dankwa Institute on the one hand, and then these Let My Vote Counts, whatever. These are all arms under the NPP. And on countless occasions, they had some fixation on the EC chair, which all till today or yesterday, up until yesterday, they are still unleashing. Even this morning, I think I've heard a new one. Okay, one group is saying that the deputy minority leader is saying that she is, Charlotte Osei is now the captain of the NDC team. Okay. The deputy general secretary of the NPP, on the other hand, is also saying that he wouldn't want to repeat those direct comments that he made. All these things go to add to what you just said. So that if the system allows this thing to continue unattended, okay, then it also feeds into other people's it gingers other people to also respond, and in most cases they go overboard, and as we have it right now. Because if Kennedy Ejiofor has been able to, you know, openly insult a woman who is the chairperson, it's not as if EC is made up of that woman alone, but then there are other commissioners, she heads it, but that, because of their own fixations about her, she's now become their whatever. Anybody just gets up and says what they like about her. People who feel aggrieved by some of these vituperations will certainly not sit and watch. Again, what I recall that brought about this discussion, especially where these Supreme Court judges were involved or were concerned, had to do with a particular comment that one of the judges made at the Supreme Court,
seeking to clarify what they meant by the initial ruling that was given.
And that comment was like, they won't sit down and watch the EC plunge the country into chaos. And some of us openly, criticized that statement. I personally thought it was premature for the judge to have made that statement, because he only asked the EC to bring names on a particular day, 6 days clear. So they have not shown any recalcitrance as to whether they are bringing this thing or not, or they won't bring it or not. So what was the speed that comment for? What was it expected to yield? So as soon as that comment was made, people who had already, you know, held some certain views.
Essentially,
about,
people latched on to it to
yes.
make. All right.
Okay.
Let me put a pause there, and we'll come back to more of the issues. But let me just let people know that you can send us your messages. I'll be taking them. It's on facebook.com/joynewsontv, also on our WhatsApp 0560-800-00. We take a quick break. We'll be right back. Thank you for joining us here on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. If you're just joining us, it's Join Caucus, and we are talking about intemperate language in our Ghanaian politics and the public space. And we've been joined by Samuel Abujinapo, who is a private legal practitioner, is representing the NPP. Good evening to you, Mr. Abujinapo, and thank you for coming in. So I'm sure you heard a bit of what the presidential staffer, Honorable Edwasare, had been saying about the use of intemperate language. And he links it to the agitation for a new voters register and how, because those who are agitating for the new voters register don't seem to be getting what they want, there's a lot of, you know, bad blood and people are saying things in the public space. For you, I'm sure, looking at the last 2 weeks and everything that has been said, the condemnations left, right and center, it's clear that there's a certain double standards, by all means, in the way we're dealing with the use of intemperate language, depending on who's using it, where that person is coming from in terms of on the political divide and the privileged position the person may hold.
Okay, thank you very much, Jifan. Let me begin by apologizing for coming in late. Good evening to your cherished viewers. There are a lot of issues that come out of this discussion or this topic, and I've listened to my friend Edwasare, and a few pertinent issues come up. The first point is that the use of intemperate language, regardless of who does it, is a conduct who should not be applauded. We have to condemn such conduct. I don't pretend to be a saint, and I don't pretend to be holier than thou, but if I used intemperate language on this your program, I expect that people will find it unacceptable. Regardless, if NDC people use language which is unacceptable, they use foul language, they use intemperate language, it has to be condemned. If MPP people use foul language, they use language which is not decent, that also needs to be condemned. Some MPP people use intemperate language? Do they use indecent language? Yes, some MPP people do. And some NDC people use intemperate? And some NDC people do. It's across board. And in a political environment anywhere in the world, there are excesses all the time. In fact, in our jurisdiction, we're even lucky that, I've never heard of any direct political killings or any, you know, act of, if you want, in other words, the top echelons of our political establishment, somebody being killed for his political views. There's in other jurisdictions it happened. Honorable Joe Cox of the
UK,
United Kingdom.
Yes.
My point is that the first principle we have to establish is that anybody who uses some sort of language which is not permissible, we all have to find the courage to condemn that person. I've had occasions to condemn some of my colleagues who have used intemperate language.
I know you have, but and in specific reference to the MP for Sindh Central, I know you have. However, many people were expecting to see that coming directly from the party. And for many people, this would probably even be the second time in reference to the said MP that the party has not come out clearly to criticize and condemn his comments.
Well, let me give you a direct response. The party takes decisions on a case-by-case basis. And the party decides on which comments or statements that it should respond to in the first place. And after it's decided to respond to a particular statement or comment on a particular statement or situation, it also has to decide on how it should do it. The party hasn't done that in this case. And I have a lot of respect for the leadership of my party, and I have confidence in their judgment. And I don't find anything particularly extraordinary about it. There are many occasions where events have happened in our country which the MPP has not commented or reacted to. There are many occasions where events have happened that the NDC leadership has not commented or responded to. What is important is that we should hold a standard across board. So that's the first point. And the second point is that, I mean, it's absolutely untenable and unacceptable for anybody to suggest that because some people have gone challenging a register or asking for a new register or asking for validation, or if you want, calling for a new register, that becomes a justifiable excuse for persons to engage in conduct which are unacceptable. The courts are there for the Ghanaian people. Our constitution established the courts, and people are actually encouraged to go to court to vent, to ventilate their grievances, as opposed to taking the laws into their own hands, or as opposed to addressing their grievances in the manner that they deem fit. So the challenge to the Register of Ghana in the Supreme Court or in our court in itself has to be commended rather than condemned. So I find it extremely
If only people would just then focus on what the issues are. But the fixation has moved from the issues in court to the Electoral Commission and the person
there
who chairs
absolutely
it.
Absolutely nothing wrong with political agitations which are within the remit of the law for whatever reason. There's nothing wrong with people agitating, canvassing, advocating.
Once people are sticking to the issues, but unfortunately, a lot of it has become personal.
There is actually
the chairperson of the EC has become a target.
We dealt with that.
The judges become a target
I'll get to that. And then, so let me move to the judges issue. And I speak to this as an officer of the court. And it's extremely important that I explain the issues. Perhaps some persons may not understand the reason why contempt is such a highly held tool of the court. And it's important that we explain to our people, so our people will appreciate. This is not an MPP-NDC matter. It's a country matter. It's a Ghana matter. Jifa, you see, society itself deliberately, both historically and contemporarily, deliberately establishes...
Try and do that in some 2 minutes for
us. Okay, in 2 minutes. As they deliberately establishes a legal framework where the court as an institution is protected in some way. Now, when it comes to contempt, it is not the judge's person which is being protected, and the authorities are bound. The literature is there for anybody to go and read. It's not Chief Justice Georgina Wood who is being protected. The law is not preventing us from dealing with Chief Justice Georgina Wood as a person. It is the institution of the court and the office of a judge. Now, the reason why the society does so, both in history, and you go and read Lord Denning's authorities, judgments on contempt, it's been established. The reason why society does so is that we all agree that the final arbiter, if my friend and I have a dispute, the end result, where we get to, the final place we get to are the courts. And therefore, we need to protect the sanctity of the court. The court cannot be allowed to be vilified, to be scandalized in a manner that society will lose confidence in a court.
Okay.
And if society loses confidence in a court, it becomes an avenue for interfering with the smooth administration of justice. Indeed, I dare say that even the parliament, so I can criticize parliament as much as I want, but there is a thin line between criticizing parliament and scandalizing parliament, or bringing the institution of parliament into disrepute. That will constitute contempt, and parliament will hold you to privileges committee.
And that is exactly the point
The comparison between the judiciary and politicians is misplaced.
Well, you may say it's misplaced,
no,
but
legally
it's
misplaced.
But Mr. Eduasari makes the point, and I think it's
a valid point
to look at that. Politicians,
yes,
or any of us who may be holding whatever position. Are we made of iron?
Let me respond
are
to that.
Are we made of wood
Let me
that we don't have feelings?
Seconds.
Are we
Let me respond to
are
that.
We people who are not deserving of similar
let
respect,
me,
dignity,
and all of
and,
that?
And all of that?
Let me respond to that.
Why should a group of people sit unconcerned when another group of people are vilified daily and made to feel like they don't matter or they must accept it because what is part of the game?
Well, so there you are in the moral realm. In the moral realm, it is immoral. It's unethical, it's against the Ghanaian societal values for me to disrespect even Edua Sare because he's my senior brother, let alone disrespect a minister, a deputy minister, and for if you want a president. Those are moral issues. But what has been triggered is a legal process. Now, we can critique the law, that's not a problem. And he's been a legislator, he's been a lawmaker, he could change the law. But in the realm of the in the legal regime, the law specially says that for society's cohesion, you cannot say certain things about the judiciary. For society's cohesion, and I say that if you want, the legislature is next to the judiciary when it comes to this kind of protection. For society's protection, you can't scandalize parliament so that you if you scandalize parliament so much so that when parliament enacts law, people can see parliament in disregard, in disrepute, and therefore say they will not obey parliament's law. That will not be good for society. If we scandalize the judiciary so much so that when the courts hand down decisions, people will say, this court which has been dragged in a mud, who is going to respect their decision? Society says it will not help society. So if you do that, you are in contempt of court. Now, that is why, for instance, in the developed societies, you can throw, and I don't know about the law today, but in the past, citizens could throw an egg at the prime minister, but you dare not throw an egg at a judge. You could throw tomatoes at the prime minister. No. You dare not do so to a judge. So that is society's architecture. And I will humbly call. I empathize with the point he's making. I associate with it. We have to be decorous when we are dealing with politicians. And in fact, we have to be decorous with all manner of persons, including persons we are even older than. That is how society.
But let me bring in Mr. Edua Sare, because
but the judiciary is more important and it's legal. It's legal.
But Mr. Duarte, I guess the fundamental thing is that at the end of the day, there are other institutions of state that must take up some of these things when they happen. In fact, Chris Akume made a very interesting comment when I spoke to him some 2 days ago about the fact that judges, that for instance, when Kennedy Ajapong made ethnocentric comments some
I was very disappointed in those comments. Lawyers never make those kinds of comments.
Some months ago.
We should know better.
The reality is that there are people in the judiciary who also make up these groups of people.
And that was so unfortunate.
Nothing stops anyone from, you know, taking action. And the security agencies took action on that. However, we are seeing, like, it's as if with the security agencies, it's different strokes for different folks. Isn't it up to the court ultimately to determine that Mr. So-so-and-so and Mr. So-so-and-so cannot implement a threatening act of sorts? How does
you see,
one institution like the DNI come to that
decision? The hypocrisy of the system is what gets or irks some of us. You see the way he's talking? The sanctity of the judiciary, blah, blah, blah. All right? You see, he's a lawyer, and I like the gestures and the emphasis. Do you understand? Because then he believes that that particular place should be given whatever it is. I am a former MP, and so I also believe that that kind of respect should be accorded the House. All right? There are three arms of government. Three.
That's what journalists, they beat us, maltreat us. Nobody has talked about that.
Wonderful.
One.
We'll come there. Three arms. So how do you sanctify two and leave a third?
Pass a law.
You see, so for me, I think that first and foremost, we are not even in the moral realms yet. I think that apart from the moral aspect of it, the president is also protected. Okay, the president under the constitution is also protected. I don't know the articles like you do, but I believe that there's enough insulation there. Just that We have bastardized the system to the extent that the president's hand is even tied.
But you have the police. No. From time to time, the police picked up panelists on different occasions from different radio stations.
And what happens?
Sought to prosecute
it ends
that.
In court, and the matter ends there.
Because all right?
The very place that people go to seek redress and reliefs for whatever, especially when it comes to libelous issues. How long does it take to deal with one case? Go and check the number of cases that are lying in court, libel cases that are sitting there unattended. Okay, but here we are. You see the speed, you see the lightning, whatever, that because it concerns a particular, the saints, the alacrity with which a group have been summoned to held under contempt to appear before. That is why I think society should rebuild, so that I don't have to become a judge before the state respects me. Okay, I don't have to become a member of the bench before I gain my respect. I like if I was listening to Asempa when I was coming, and they were playing Justice Guba's comments when Sir John appeared before them, and the kind of voice and the anger and the emotions and so on. And we were all frightening watching television that yes, for once there is some sense of what, because the system has been so fraught with,
But if politicians are doing whatever to themselves,
yes,
obviously the people won't respect you.
Wonderful. I agree with you, because the politicians among us, ourselves, we don't respect each other. Okay? I believe that it can start from our own homes or wherever we find ourselves. When I started radio, sometimes when I'm on radio, people call me and say, what are you sitting there for? You are too soft. Okay? The guy, punch him, do this, use some of those words.
So you think the society itself is hypocritical?
Yes. Again, especially when it comes to, I've said this thing, and I want to repeat myself again, that sometimes that we bring street language, okay, onto programs, okay, and especially in the
local languages,
we import the kind of language that we speak on the streets. At least English, there are some restrictions. Even when you are going to say something about somebody, you want to use the word allege. What is the word allege? How does it sound in tree? So it goes straight and hits somebody without all those things that at least can insulate the person when they are speaking. I mean, as it will be the case when the person is speaking English. So here we are. We need a system that purges itself, okay, so that the host of the program himself has some laid down principle, guidelines, and all of that. They know their limits, okay. And before we started this program, I don't intend to take your station on. But in the last 2 weeks or so, what has happened? I had to take on one particular host of your program, and deal with him as much as I thought. And I like the fact that the management has taken some decision. I don't know whether that is true or not.
We missed his voice on Monday. Monday, I'm Joy FM by 5:30. I'm tuning. Kojo Yangson is coming on Monday. Oh, this is going to be beautiful.
Wonderful.
I've never met him though.
But again,
I like that guy.
No heckle.
He's very intelligent. He's very articulate.
Stop this because I can do that.
Abu, don't heckle.
As for my wife, she's in love with him.
Abu, don't heckle.
So all I'm saying.
So for you, we need to sanitize the system.
We need to sanitize, and then for the hosts of the program, because you see, people are saying that I didn't watch that program that has brought these gentlemen before the Supreme Court. I'm told that at a point the host was also leading them on and all of that. I believe if we had some of these checks and balances in the system, it will guide. And sometimes you, the anchors, your comments, which is not part of the news item.
Opinionated comments.
Exactly. They also feed into these things. And we all have to watch ourselves. Other than that, Because you may think, well, I'm just passing a comment. Several thousands of people will feel, may feel offended, or the other way around, just by virtue of wherever the fit in that particular comment. If it goes against somebody that I like, somebody that I support, then you are going to be my target. Whenever I find opportunity, I will hit back.
Okay, I'll come back to you because there's an issue relating to the media space and hosts that we can still address. But the issue is that once politicians treat themselves with disrespect and younger politicians are picking up on that, it will never end. Well, because there was a time that, yes, maybe there were some older politicians not used to the media space who would say things in a manner that we had to eventually accept because that's how they are. But you would have expected that the up-and-coming ones would make it a point to sanitize. They are even worse.
Very well. I will speak to that directly. Before I do, let me just make two quick preliminary points. One, the Constitution of Ghana vests the judiciary. The superior courts, the High Court, the Court of Appeal, the Supreme Court, it vests them the contempt powers, powers of to cite contempt. That's the Constitution. I'm not saying it. The Constitution vests Parliament with powers of contempt to cite a person for contempt. It's not Abu Jinapo who is saying it. The Constitution doesn't vest the executives with powers to cite for contempt.
Let me finish.
I'm making a point.
So they can be insulted
I haven't said so. I've even gone as far as saying that we shouldn't even insult our younger persons in society. So it is the Constitution, the framers of the 1980s, they did so. They put it in there. I didn't. Now, I've already tried to explain the reason why I believe the framers did it that way, because there's jurisprudence to that effect. Now, let me leave it. Chris Akumi's comment. I find it, but I'll deal with
why,
it.
Why,
I find
no, it's okay.
Because first of all, I don't expect, with the greater respect to him, I mean, I don't expect a lawyer who is an officer of the court to say that why is it that when Kine Japon said this about guns and Evers, the judges who are guns and never didn't cite him for contempt or didn't punish him. First of all, basic MP, contempt is not personal. It's not if you read the law. It is a public. So if you attack the court, it's as if you attack the whole of Ghana. Mm-hmm. It's not the judge as a person. So the judge who is, whether the judge is...
I think the point is just trying to make is that any issue like that should be taken just as serious. And the issue came before the court. And then there's a feeling
that...
You are
not let go. When Sir John insulted...
When Sir John insulted Justice Atuguba,
was it the court or was it Justice Atuguba? He was cited for contempt. No, it's a court. That's the law. I'm telling you. They take it from me on authority. It's not Justice Atuguba. If Justice Atuguba resigned that day as a judge, Sir John would still be hauled before the court for contempt of court. It's not an individual.
Okay, but you were making the point.
So you get a point.
Okay, you were
so
making the somebody, point
if
that
somebody was
Mr. Jepo was
scandalized
not
you as an MP. Even if you resign as an MP, the person is still in contempt of parliament.
Okay, so you're making the point that Mr. Jepong didn't let go.
He was granted bail. The prosecution discontinued the case. It wasn't as if he was acquitted. So to even say that the court let him go, if anybody let him go, it's the Attorney General. And who is a minister in that government. But those are not the fundamental issue, the most fundamental issue. And if I read my lips, I don't like anything tribalism. I abhor it. So even that whole notion of, you know, reoccurring tribal sentiments and the rest, it's not good for our country. What was this business of every now and again our friends like to gag every Ashanti Fanta?
Oh, but someone resurrected
it. We condemned it.
Yes. We are all one people in this country. Mm-hmm. And then this thing about politicians, let me make a very important point as well. Let's also be careful not to gag people. Let also be careful not to make people feel timid. It is a very fine line which we have to guard. We need to differentiate between, if you want, passionate views, c-
criticisms, as harsh as they may be, robust debate from blatant insults.
And I don't want to... Or the use of unsubstantiated allegations or outright lies.
Yes. In fact, if you are categorizing them, I would say insults. Blatant insults is number one, which
like,
we have to,
like
we have to cut
Japan
off. And I really don't want to be drawn into this MPP and this thing.
No,
I don't
no, that's
deal
what's
this
happening.
Matter.
Because
no,
every night, no, then you guys...
Because then I will begin to give you countless examples of things that NDC
process. Yeah, because it's this not thing when it happened.
Okay, but beyond,
this
okay,
is,
it's true,
very,
but
it's a very
I think
thing
the,
when it
the,
happened,
I think
the
point
NDC
is that there's the issue of the partisan...
You know what? Let me tell you something. I declined this enthusiastic invitation by my friend from the beginning of this program. Mm. This is obsession about Kennedy Japan. This
no, and you don't
no, let me finish. Let me finish. You can go on that
like,
tangent. I'm
fine,
not going.
I'm
not
calling
going,
you there.
I'm not going to join you in that free.
Fine.
Continue.
Okay, but I was
but
asking
the point
you
I'm making,
about the politicians you would have so hoped
I,
would improve the situation.
So I'm
by
making
this.
The point that we can have a very passionate, robust debate about the issues which affect our people, as opposed to blatant insults. And this is not... this is not just a problem in Ghana. There is a member of parliament in Britain, a Labour MP, called Dennis something, I've forgotten the other name, who referred to Prime Minister David Cameron recently, a month or so ago, as Dodgy David.
He was removed from the House of Commons.
Dennis Skip also, I've forgotten the name. He was walked out of the House of Commons. There's another House of Representative in U.S., who shouted at President Obama, "You lie, you liar," also, and he was reprimanded in the House. So I'm saying to you that let us focus on politics of issues. They may be very passionate. I hold very strong views, very strong political views, and I don't hesitate to express them. That should be encouraged, as opposed to blatant insults in the realm of lies and statements which tend to defame politicians. They should be discouraged. But there is also a remedy. The remedy is that politicians should also feel encouraged to take people on in the law court in an attempt to restore or protect their reputation. And again, there are countless examples. Lin Kuan Yew of Singapore. One of
just
the,
come back to Ghana. Hakman Oswajima went Oswajima. To court.
Hakman Oswajima is a classic
NDC,
example. He's been
NDC's,
very active in court.
The NDC's general secretary,
Alete Jacob. Alete Jacob says it's in court. Cite Alete Jacob.
We want to bury the very fundamental.
I think we've talked a lot
no,
about Kennedy
no,
Jacob, so
no. You see, let's not
that.
Make it look like somebody has a fixation on anybody. Mm. If that is the genesis of the issue, let's deal
no,
with it.
No, it's not.
If that is the source that is causing, giving others the impetus, the bravado to go ahead and do some of these things. Because you see, this thing hasn't stopped. It hasn't stopped since Kennedy Japan said these things. Every blessed day.
Okay, but prior to that, other politicians
please. I haven't
been
there.
Are we here to discuss
if you don't let me speak, I will keep quiet so that you take the rest of the time.
Make your point.
Because I sit here and watch you talk and you don't want to listen to anybody.
It's okay, Mr.
Listen, talk about Kennedy Japan.
What I'm saying is this, that we are in a country where some people feel, you asked a very important question earlier. Why is it that some of these guys feel emboldened, okay, to continue in this tangent? Because the party they belong to has given them, opened that floodgate. Because the very person who started it has not been reprimanded.
Okay, but it doesn't mean that they are not members of your party.
Which members are we talking about?
Let me give you one example.
Remember the famous comment about there are many ways to kill a cat?
Please.
Let me give an example.
Just call for clarification.
Let me give an example.
If they were felt offended,
ask for an example.
Please, is it my time?
Let me give an example. You're asking for an example.
No, I've given him one example.
What is your problem? You see, my friend,
I will give him the example.
That
I will.
We When this issue when it came up only last week, the organizer of a party came out and condemned and warned any NDC person who gets into such unnecessary mess will be on their own. We said this openly. Okay? That is what a responsible party does. You don't sit there and watch your people throw issues out there on daily basis. Deputy minority leader is on one tangent. A deputy general secretary is another tangent. And there are youth organizers all over the place throwing tantrums at AC. And nobody seems to be interested in checking.
Calling anyone to order.
You understand? So please, trust me. Tomorrow another one will come. The next day it will follow. Because there's no leader who is worth his salt to stop it.
Okay, but beyond that,
reprimand somebody.
Please, Mr. But then beyond that, there is also the issue of within the media space.
Yes.
Who owns the media?
Right.
Once the media is owned by a politician, obviously they are serving someone's partisan political interest.
For me,
and there is a certain feeling that, I mean, there is no link, but there's a certain feeling that the station that has now been summoned to court, one would have thought that if this had been someone else, the BNI would have arrested these people, held them for whatever period and the like. Mm. There's a certain feeling that because they may have links to government, that is why they are being treated with kid's glove, but for the fact that the court has now summoned them.
You see, I don't show the BNI how to do their work. They have the mandate to investigate some of these issues of this magnitude and assess the issues and handle it as they fit, as they deem fit. In this matter,
You saw the statement they issued.
Of course, I've read it. All I'm saying is that, personally, if you want me to lace myself with this radio station, yes, I will. Because the owner of the station is somebody I know. He belongs to my party. So I know him. But the owner and his management have rendered unqualified apology for whatever has been done. So I cannot hold them responsible for whatever. They have dissociated themselves with the program. They have.
And taken an action.
So I can only sit here and plead with the judges to, as much as possible, tamper justice with mercy on behalf of these guys. That's all the best I can do. But as to whether the BNI did their work right or not, I'm not in a position to determine how they are supposed to handle it just because one or two cases were handled in a particular way. So that it becomes the yardstick by which all other issues should be measured. I don't think I have what it takes to do that. But on a more serious note, I think that...
In 1 minute.
Yes, I will quickly wrap up. I want a situation where we all look at the responsibility that sits with us, whether we are politicians, whether we are whatever.
When
we
find out
whether you are the host of a program, a moderator, whatsoever, you also have... I have sat in this same studio where a guest has been asked to leave a program, hot program. I was here. And that person was, took off all the... and walked out because a certain language he used was wrong, and they said, please, you have to apologize. He said, I won't. Then he said, excuse me, please, then you may have to leave this program. And he left. For me, if we started these things...
Or stuck to those things.
Yes, those principles. So we don't look at people and think that, oh, this one belongs to me. This one, I don't like his face. This man, his face doesn't look good for me. So let me just allow him to throw it. Even some of the calls, when people call in, they are allowed to speak in a certain way and get away with it. Others start speaking, and the next moment, they get cut or interrupted and so on. And all these gimmicks, excuse my language, people can read meanings into it. Morning shows, when it's time to call it, people
the
call
phone-in segments,
take a listen to it. You will find that one particular lead...
You feel it skewed sometimes.
And then before you realize, the whole... whatever is going a certain direction. So somebody comes in and brings an opposing view, and that person is
nudged out.
You see,
for you, it gives
I
a certain.
Think all of
there
us
must
have
be a better balance.
Wonderful.
All right, Mr. Jinapo.
Well, I have a few things to say.
You have 3 minutes, so you have to compress it.
I've been very quiet, and you give me a lot of opportunity.
No, anyway, but you had proceed. A good chance.
Let me proceed. I've been very quiet because I want to get opportunity to make my point.
Anyway, and you have 3 minutes, so compress
that,
it.
I thought that we're going to have a very dispassionate discussion about this topic so that Ghanaian
politics... He's made his point. Go ahead and make the point that you want.
That's the point I'm making. So that Ghanaian politics will be better off, Ghana will be better off. My friend is... just demonstrate an obsession to attack the MPP.
Forget now, about that.
No, because that's the point I'm making. That's the point I'm making. That he's developed, he's shown an obsession to attack the MPP. Now, if there's a political party in Ghana whose character, trait, and nature is born out of venom, vituperation, and vitriolic language, it's the National Democratic Congress. There's no other political party. If there's a political party...
But why would you want to use venom, betrayal?
But that is what they do. That is what they do. Can I make the point? That is what they do. This is a political party.
It fits you better.
This is a political
party. People who are watching knows what you are talking about.
And you know, the hypocrisy is just mind-boggling. The hypocrisy.
On whose part?
This is on their part, including my friend. These are the people, leading members of their party, who publish stories in their pro party tabloid that Akufo-Addo is a murderer. This is the political party. This is the political party that referred to the MPP as a narcotics people's party. This is the political party we are talking about. This is a political party whose deputy minister, a leading deputy minister, referred to Akufo-Addo as a, quote, sexy old fool, end quote. Nobody condemned him. Hey, that is the political party we are talking about. This is the political party whose leader and president and presidential candidate referred to a leading opponent of his political party, an acting national chairman, as Opana. This is the political... No, I'll give you more examples. Hold on. This is...
Okay.
Let me finish. Let me finish.
You have only 2 minutes.
Let me conclude. So the point I'm making
Opana
is that... Opana
means what?
What should pay us with this is sanctimonious, hypocritic effusions. Your political party, you are coming to sit here to talk about MPP being a party that engages in a party of insults. You see, there's something
but the Media Foundation for West Africa reports that have taken over. Over the last three reports,
there is a final
points to the MPP.
There is a final point I need to make. There's a final point I need to make. Jifa, and read my lips. If what makes him uncomfortable is the passionate, active, and almost unyielding attempt by our party to expose the gargantuan corruption which is in their government. Oh. We can't help them. If you want us to, if you want people to cow down into timidity and cow down people and cow people out of boldness and courage to expose the rot in their government and at the heart of the presidency. If those are the things that constitutes us, Mr. Duasari, we can't help you. We are sorry.
You've heard of the media foundation.
When you go and take podcast as a bribe,
okay,
and
no,
we
no,
expose
no,
you. That cannot be an insult.
That is not.
That cannot be an insult.
The point is that if you say they are not your members. You say they are not your members.
And we say we expose you.
You said they are not your members.
Bring on, bring on the next joke.
And I think that's where we have to end the program. And thank you very much for watching. Join Caucus on the Joy News channel on Multi TV. Thank you to our guests, Kojo Eduasai, presidential staffer representing the NDC. Also to Samuel Abujinapo, representing the NPP, private legal practitioner. Sorry we couldn't bring you your messages today due to a technical fault. My name is Jifa Bampu. Join the Minority Caucus on Thursdays. Join the Majority Caucus on Wednesdays. And then we bring you Join Caucus on Fridays. Thank you.